Hello there, everybody. Today I want to talk to you all about functions. I really do. In this school, I'll give it to you straight, just like my A's, and get right into the definitions. But this is not school. It's the internet. We're learning so as to be fun. So like wrapping dog medicine in peanut butter, I first want to bait you in with a tantalizing simple puzzle about an impossible shape. Imagine for a second an infinite grid, where all the horizontal and vertical lines are spaced one unit apart from each other. This is nice for a few reasons, one of which being that each box on the grid has an area of one. Now on this grid, imagine there's a shape with area less than one, say this guy right here. Now as it's currently placed, this shape's touching a corner, which for the purposes of this puzzle is bad, bad shape. Corners are sharp and dangerous and should be avoided. So the question is it possible for this shape to avoid them? Luckily for this shape here, we can. Just by moving it around on the grid, not changing its size or form, we can easily find a placement where it avoids all those terrible corners. And it's easy for this shape, but the question is this always the case? Could there exist a crazy shape such that no matter how you move it on the grid, it will always touch a corner somewhere? Or, for any shape with area less than one, will there always be some way we can move it to avoid all the corners? That's the hook, let's get into it. All right, so if you haven't seen this puzzle before, I highly recommend pausing the video now and trying it for yourself, your country, and your family. So the problem is that even though this puzzle is really simple to state, it's incredibly hard to even start to prove. And I think it's important to see this challenge on your own to have an appreciation for its solution and the solution's muse, functions. Functions, or sometimes called mappings, are by far one of the most misunderstood things that you learned in eighth grade. It may have been described to you in this way, as some sort of black box Dr. Seuss machine that inputs an X, does some stuff to it, and outputs a Y. But functions are actually much more than that. A function, simply put, is just any connection we can describe between two sets. For example, we could connect this group of letters to the numbers 1 through 10 like this, where A connects to 1, B to 2, C to 3, on and on and on like that. We can describe these connections visually with the lines on the screen here. Now, this group of connections as a whole is what we would call a function, and this particular function I've decided to name f. One convention we have with functions is that if you write the function name f, and then in parentheses anything on the left side, like g for example, that's asking what number on the right connects to g, which is 7 in this case. Because of this, it's important that our function only connect to exactly one thing on the right side. Because if, for example, g connected to multiple numbers on the right, what would we say f of g is? This property of functions is known as well-definedness. Now, this idea of functions may seem abstract and mathematical, but I promise you it's not. As humans, we make deep connections between two different groups of sets all the time, even for fun. For example, have you ever sat down and tried to figure out which characters from your favorite TV show you and your friends would be? You might think that, oh, he's such a Ross and they are absolutely Monica and Chandler and he's too Joey. It's fun. If you haven't done this, I recommend pausing the video and trying it yourself. It's a blast. But if you have done it, congratulations, you've made a function between your friend group and the TV show character's friend group. And why do we make these functions exactly? It's not just to list a group of connections, no, there'd be hardly any point to that. We make functions between two groups in hopes that we can use information about one group to tell us something that we want to know about another group. And the function is the guide we use for navigating between them. Now back to our example, notice that in the show Friends, Ross and Rachel are very like-likey with each other. So maybe if your one friend connects to Ross and your other friend connects to Rachel, their relationship is like-likey as well. Or since Joey's the biggest womanizer of the group, maybe your friend that connects to Joey likes to date around too. That would just make sense. And this navigating concept is why functions are also called maps. Because what is a map but a connection between the real world and drawings on a piece of paper? The reason we use a map is to use the information about where the destination is on the map to determine what direction we should go in real life. And this may not sound very mathematical until you realize it's all still about finding x. Now, sometimes a function can be used to transfer or translate information about one group into information about another group, but that doesn't always work. Like back to our friends example, we saw that this function was relationship preserving, meaning that if two people had a relationship in the right group, their respective connectors in the left group would also have a history. But that doesn't mean that this function must also be job preserving or nationality preserving or anything like that. Now, no function does everything. Most functions only really translate one particular type of information from one set to the other set. So it's important that before we use a function, we determine which types of information are preserved beforehand before we use the function to make any grand conclusions about either set being connected. With all of that said, We now have everything we need to get back to that delicious peanut butter about the question of allegedly impossible shapes on the grid. When I was first given this question, I was admittedly smittenly confused about how to even start. The one thing I noticed is that this question about if we can move the shape on the grid to avoid the corners is equivalent to asking if we can move the grid in such a way that the corners avoid the shape. Take a minute to recognize that these two perspectives are equivalent, and then take a second minute to recognize how great you are, because both these will be important later on. Even with this new perspective shift and all the self-love in the world, this problem is still insanely hard to get our hands on. The issue is that even though this shape has area less than one, it could be as skinny or as sneaky as it wants, possibly meandering around this entire infinite grid. So how could we ever show that no matter how skinny, how sneaky, how meandering it gets, there's still some way we can move the shape so that it avoids all the corners? And how the heck does this connect with the fact that the area of the shape is less than the area of one of our boxes on the grid? Why does that matter at all? And connection here turns out to be the key word, because solving this puzzle is going to come down to translating knowledge through a very particular and interesting function. Specifically, a function which maps the entire infinite grid, where the shape lives, to just one special box, which remember, has area 1. That'll be our connection. The particular box we say is special does not matter at all here. I'm not its mom, I don't have favorites. We just need to pick one box at random to be our reference box. Let's pick this one right here. Now we'll map the whole grid to this box as so. For each box in the grid, we will send every point in that box to the analogous point in our reference box. So the top left corner goes to the top left corner, the bottom right corner goes to the bottom right corner, and so on and so forth with everything in between. And remember that we don't just do this for that one box, but every single box in the infinite grid gets mapped to the reference box in that same way. In whole, this creates one giant function, i.e. connection, between our infinite grid and that one single box of area 1. For all you math nerds out there, if you were to label the grid like a Cartesian plane, this is how the function would look algebraically. Now back to the math jock content though. The beauty of connecting the infinite grid to this one single box is that, remember, our shape lives in the grid. So if we pass our shape through this function, the output will be some interesting new shape that lives entirely in the reference box. Here's now where we need to notice two essential properties of this function we just created. One is that this function is what we'll call intersection preserving. What that means is that if a shape and a point intersect in the infinite grid, when passed through the function, their outputs will intersect in the reference box as well. Additionally though, and here's the important one, this function is also what we'll call at most area preserving. What I mean by this is that for any shape that lives in the infinite grid, when it gets passed through the function, the resulting shape in the reference box will have area at most the area of the shape you started with, but probably less even. The reason for this is that our function essentially breaks up a shape into several different pieces based on which box they inhabit, and then rearranges all those pieces in the reference box. And as breaking up and rearranging the parts of a shape cannot magically add any area, this new shape in the reference box can have at most the area of the shape you started with, unless if there's any overlap in the output at all. All right, so how are we gonna use this intersection preserving and at most area preserving function to show beyond any doubt that any shape with area less than one in the infinite grid can be moved to avoid all the corners? Well, imagine for a second a shape with area less than one on our grid. Send that shape to the function and let's see what output we get in the reference box. Notice, since this function is at most area preserving, that means that the resulting shape in the reference box must have area less than the shape we started with, which remember was less than one. That means the area of the output shape is less than the area of the box it inhabits. That means there must be some space in that box not taken up by the shape. And the crazy thing is, we're still not done using this function yet. So now that we have our empty space, pick out any point in that space and call it P, short for Phoebe. Now we need us to imagine sending this point P back to the function in reverse, i.e. finding all points in the infinite grid which would connect to P. And since analogous points in each box of the grid get sent to the same point in a reference box, that would lead us to all of these infinitely many points here, which wind up making their own sort of infinite offset grid. And here it's time to translate knowledge through our function one last time. Remember from the very beginning we noted our function is what we called intersection preserving. This means that if our shape in the infinite grid intersected any of these P pals, then when the shape was sent through the function, the output shape would have to intersect P as well. But since P was specifically chosen to be in the empty space, not intersecting our output shape at all, that means that our original shape could not possibly have intersected any of the P pals to begin with. This is the light at the end of the tunnel, people. Since all of our reverse translated P's make their own infinite grid, why not just move our grid so the bottom right corner of the reference box goes to P? Then we should see the corners of our original grid perfectly match up with these reverse connected p-pals, which remember, all avoid the shape. Meaning we just found a way to move the grid such that all of the corners avoid the shape. And since the particular shape didn't matter at all here, that means for any shape with area less than 1, we know there's some way we can move it which avoids all the corners. Or put differently, this crazy shape, which no matter how we move it, it's gotta hit a corner, is impossible. Now it's important to note that this solution was brilliant, and I'm okay saying that because this is not my solution. I heard this from a friend at a barbecue. It's just my job to share the brilliance with you all. And it's important to note that this solution would not be possible without functions. Functions are the mathematical tool that we use to connect different parts of math and to train our knowledge about each one through each other so we can all learn more together. That's why functions are important. All right, thank you all for watching our video about impossible shapes, which is actually about functions. Hit that in there. If you like that kind of thing, we only make videos like that kind of thing. So go ahead and like, subscribe, ring the bell, whatever the hell that does, and comment your favorite shape, comment what you want to see next. Thank you.